again, it's great. Thanks to RSPCA for hosting us, because it is quite timely. There's a lot happening in this wildlife space at the moment, across the whole of it. One of the things I didn't put on my slides that I will mention to begin with, and I should have probably had some slides to focus on this, is last Thursday, Minister Neville released a draft of a biodiversity plan for Victoria. So it's protecting Victoria's environment, biodiversity 2036. So there's a new plan out there for public consultation that'll be out there for 8 weeks. And there's lots of opportunities if people want to engage directly around that. If you want to find it, I should have had it up on the slide, I do apologise for that. If you just Google DELWP, have your say. There's a sort of a site there where all of the things that are up for consultation from the department are there. So for that's there for you. One of the key things in that strategy, in one of our key goals, is to help Victorians value nature. And I think, so there's a real focus within that around how we connect with nature and what people's experiences of nature, and obviously wildlife is very much part of that. And as we think about these issues around how we manage wildlife, one of the things I think that's useful for us to keep remembering is how privileged we are to have wildlife around us. So even to, in areas where we don't expect it, around the centre of Melbourne, places like that, we still have wildlife, and we need to value that, and that's part of, I think certainly at times there are impacts and we need to look at that, but also it is, rather than just focusing, I think it's good, it's just on the negative things sometimes around wildlife causing problems, sometimes it's good for us to take time and celebrate the place that particularly our native wildlife has in, as much as anything, who we are as Australians, some of our wildlife there is quite iconic. So that's probably by way of a little bit of background. Having said that, I have to admit, and I don't think I've got a photo of wildlife in my presentation. I think you'll have, you can read whatever you like into that. I think probably the most sensible thing to read into it is my lack of PowerPoint and skills, etc. So, please. That is a bit of an introduction. As I said, have a look at the biodiversity plan and really would appreciate people's feedback. Particularly in the context of what we're talking about today, one of the things we do look at is this question of fluctuating populations and how we've modified our systems and how we have systems in balance, really is the question. So some of the issues that we face with wildlife are at times because our systems get out of balance. And I'll talk about the koalas a little bit later as one example where systems kind of get a bit out of balance and we need to manage. So that's a key question. How do we manage our systems and keep them in balance? I did want to, as we go through this, I'll touch on a couple of higher level directions and challenges around wildlife management. But then I will use the work around Cape Otway koalas as one example, and also touch on kangaroo management, which was quite timely in the last questions. So as we go through that, and as we think about this, obviously I'll talk about koalas, we'll talk about kangaroos, but there are lots of other examples, such as possums, we deal with wombats, we deal with seagulls, and people need to control seagulls in certain circumstances, and corellas, and there are lots and lots of examples where really people are interacting with wildlife, and a lot of what we're doing in this space is around, I think, regulating in a sense how people interact with wildlife as much as anything. So one of the things that was touched on is how broad the range of things we're trying to achieve with wildlife is. So, and these aren't in any particular order, but these are all things that are very, very much relevant to the discussion as we go through. So, obviously animal welfare outcomes are really important within this, and again, Cape Otway example is one that was focused around welfare as a key issue. Within that too is this sense in which wildlife is vital and should remain wild as part of its the questions around its welfare, and somehow how we step through then our strategies, etc., need to where we can acknowledge that. Community safety comes into play, so whether it be road safety or other things, that there are issues that we need to be thinking through and managing. There is conservation of wildlife and ensuring that we have sustainable populations into the future, so that we're not in a situation where some of the things that today are common wildlife become threatened in the future. We've got not a particularly good record at all in Victoria about the loss of particularly our native fauna, and so that's something that we need to be mindful of as we're looking at how we manage our wildlife, including wildlife that we see as common wildlife. There's impacts on other land uses from wildlife, agriculture being probably the prime example of that. But we also have examples of where systems out of balance and wildlife then causing impacts on our biodiversity and the health of perhaps the vegetation and other things. And so the need there to look at how we help systems to remain in balance. And I think Phil might touch on that later on in the discussion. There's also the sustainable use of wildlife, and clearly within one of the key objectives in the Wildlife Act, as it's written currently, that's one of the key pieces that we need to refer to. The sort of the grounding of the work that we do with the Wildlife Act is provides one of those objectives is for sustainable use of wildlife. So that's obviously there. Topical with duck hunting season opening, and ponds. We appreciate there's a range of rules around that, but that's one of the things that's set out there within the Act and within the government's programs. The other one which is relevant there is the Flora and Fauna Guarantee Act, and we don't often think about that, but it does also provide within that for strategies which is really about managing the broader threats to our biodiversity, including our native wildlife. So it's not just, people sometimes thought of the Flora and Fauna Guarantee Act as just about the threat of the endangered things. It has a broader remit. We probably haven't implemented it in that context very well, but that it does have a broader remit. So some of the challenges. Some of the things, I'll touch on some of the things we do first, and this is not by any means an exhaustive list, within that context, there is, I suppose, a starting point is to think about DELWP as we do have a role in managing a system of how people interact with wildlife. So fundamentally, we administer legislation. So administering legislation, there's jobs there that we need to do which are regulatory in their nature, so we need to, all the Act sets up that all wildlife in Victoria is protected. That's the starting point. So if you're going to do things with certain wildlife, there needs to be some authority or some approval or some permission that occurs. And so we have a thing called authorities to control wildlife, which is a permit that allows people to control. Often it's read in the context of it's all about killing wildlife. Very often those permits are about authorities to capture or to move or to otherwise have activities that disturb or manage wildlife in non-lethal ways. Sometimes there are classes of problems or issues that where we have, okay, if you do it in this way, then you're allowed to do it. We have orders. We license people to keep and to trade. So there's very strict controls on taking wildlife from the wild, but there is wildlife within the commercial trade system as it stands, and so we regulate that. So there's some of the things that we do. We obviously then also look at how to conserve threatened fauna, as was mentioned earlier, and managing the threats to wildlife. In an emergency context, we have a role. So Wye River example most recently, where working with a whole range of network volunteers and the like, we do look to identify the wildlife that's been impacted by fire and provide some care for that. It is a really tricky situation, as you might imagine, because we know people want to get in there and provide care for wildlife. We're also needing to manage the safety of the fire ground and all the other processes that run around that. So I think that's one area where we've been doing better, but we still have probably some further opportunities to improve. We also have other kinds of wildlife emergencies that are ours to manage, such as scrambling sort of recitations and the like. We do wildlife rehabilitation, licensing and grants for people who are in that space. We'll come back to it later, but it's probably the only example I can think of where the department takes a broader role in how we're managing a population or a species in a place, because usually it's the land manager. Sometimes it's the department's the land manager, sometimes it's other public land managers, like the parks, if they're managing wildlife and land. Well, it's probably one of the only examples I can think of where we're much more active in a couple of places where we're managing populations, largely from an animal welfare perspective. So some of the challenges, and not to time the places, but there are strongly held views, as was mentioned earlier, and different interests and perceptions around wildlife. They vary across the state, and people's experience and living circumstances and backgrounds and own values and other things are. And so we know whenever we're working in this space, we're working often in a space where there are some strongly held views. So the question is then how do we step through that? Because it's going to be very difficult to get everyone entirely comfortable with what's been done. We are seeing, and I think we can expect to continuously, increasingly the interactions with wildlife and people emerging continuing to grow. We've got, as Melbourne grows, the extent to which we're interacting with wildlife in the, particularly in the urban fringe is there, and the people in the room know that so much better than I do, but I'm very conscious of that. We've got as different things happen in the environment, climate varies, etc. Populations will grow and then contract, etc. So, and we are at a point at the moment where we don't count the number of kangaroos in Victoria, the total number of kangaroos, but in particular places where we do look, and by all the information that we can gather, we do have increasing numbers of kangaroos at the moment, in probably in reflection of where we are in the cycle of that, how those populations operate. So they're things that we need to be aware of and to be managing. When we need to intervene in some way, often we're working across multiple land managers. So, an owner doesn't stay just on the park because it knows there's a sign there saying this is the end of the park and then there's private land. So how do you, whenever we're working in these spaces, there's often a need to be working with adjoining landholds, working across multiple tenures, and it's all of that, the challenges that come with that. And in so many places here, there's balances that we need to strike. There are strong views, there's multiple outcomes that we're trying to see, whether it be to manage impacts on agricultural production, and manage animal welfare and so on. There are different things that how do we just keep all of those things in balance? And again, often it's a situation where we need to work that through, form a view and move forward. We keep engaging with the community, be transparent about that, and just acknowledge that not everyone can necessarily agree with those positions, but let's put them out and be clear about how the decisions are made and so on. So that's some of those things. I'd like to talk just a little bit about hay popping. So the particular challenge out there is that there are other examples around the state where similarly we have history of managing koalas in a place where they've had impacts on the local environment, and then that as a, in turn creates risks of starvation and things like that. So these places, this has happened in a number of places. We have over decades, we have practice or we've observed situations where populations have grown up and then they've crashed as a result of living food, starvation and so on. So we've seen this in different places, and look, it's also a reflection that this is a circumstance where we're dealing with an animal across a highly modified and fragmented landscape from where we started in Victoria, and one in which we, you know, early settlers and I did a very good job of just about wiping out the koala in Victoria and came back down to some very small populations, and most of the populations of Victoria of koalas have then been re-established over time through the practices of the department and with many previous guys, is about reintroducing koalas across the landscape. That's got all sorts of pluses and minuses in it. But I think it's probably the starting point is to say this is a highly modified construct kind of situation. In Cape Otway, we've got the Cape Otway National Park, and then we have an area of private land that abuts the park, and you can see there from the aerial photo that there's been a fair bit of clearing over time in that space, and it's resulted in quite a fragmented area where with clumps of manor etc., which koalas love, and other areas which are now cleared and so on. And you can see, what I would say is that clearing occurred some time ago. There hasn't been any recent substantive clearing that I'm aware of in that area. But it does show the nature of the challenge in the landscape that we're working in, and there's nothing physically to stop the koalas moving backwards and forwards between the national park and those private landscapes. So just going through the 20s, through the 80s, as I said, you know, we done a good job at almost causing the extinction of koalas in Victoria, and then you went through a process of translocating those koalas to various places across the state. In the 80s, they were introduced to the Cape Otway area. In the 2000s, we started to see the habitat, particularly the manor gums that the koalas love, become to be overgrazed. And towards the late 2000s, the community was starting to raise issues about the numbers of koalas and the like in that landscape and the impacts they were having. Certainly in the first instance, a number of the local community were very keen to have koalas there as part of a great, you know, as part of that national place, part of the tourist attraction and all of the rest. But then also have started to realise the impacts and were raising some real concerns. So in 2013, we're starting to get some reports of significant poor health in Cape Otway, koala health. Normally, and there are others that have a lot more of a technical background on this than I, but normally we see kind of sustainable population levels of koalas in most koala landscapes is a couple of hectare. We were seeing 20 koalas per hectare in some areas down on the Cape Otway area. So clearly well above what that landscape is going to sustain. We also, there's a photo I should have put in of a single tree, a single manor gum, almost denuded of all foliage with similar koalas sitting in it. And we don't understand, this is probably my area, there might be others who do understand this, but why, for example, koalas don't necessarily move to the next area where we've got the national park adjoining. So they can move places, but they seem to love the manor gums in this particular area, and it's one of the things that holds them in that space. So part of this is also understanding how and why koalas are behaving as they are. That's one of the challenges in this. Through through 2013 and 14, three emergency welfare interventions were conducted, and for the, just to explain, that did involve staff themselves and parks Victoria and others capturing koalas, which is known in feet given they're up in trees and the like, had taken from the station where vets would assess them and then make an assessment of what the prospects for that koala is. Those that were healthy were tagged and released, and the females were provided with a hormone implant for fertility control as a start towards the managing the population and their location. And those that were unhealthy, that were assessed as unlikely to survive in the wild, were euthanized. And the assessment of the vets was the combination of the condition of those koalas and the prospects of them actually being able to recover within a landscape that's already limited in terms of food source and so on, meant that the best thing to do was to euthanize. So that occurred through 2013 and 14. Asked us to convene a panel of scientists in 2015 to start to give some further advice about what should be done in this location. We did that, we came up with a set of management actions. All of this information is available on our website for those who want to go back and check in the details. And there's also some great videos of the team explaining what they're doing as they've been doing those interventions. So that's worth having a look at. But those health assessments were completed in May, so there was a quick check to say how's this population travelling, is it still suffering? And then in September that year we went in to do two things. Further, I suppose, health assessment as well as then to do a trial of translocation some of those files to another place. So as was mentioned earlier, fertility control has its limits in terms of how to manage the impacts in a place when there's already a large population. So part of the strategy is, well, how do we provide an opportunity for that habitat to recover so it can sustain koalas at the same time managing the welfare issues? And so there was a decision to trial the translocation, so 37 koalas were translocated. At that time, there's about 400 cysts, and about 50 were sufficiently ill that they needed to be euthanized at that time. So that was kind of the place where we were starting to trial and say, look, can we use translocation effectively in this context as a way of managing this population in a reasonable way that would enable them that the habitat and the like capable to recover. The initial results from the trial were positive, and then in November and December we translocated about 400 healthy adult koalas from Cape Hot Way to another location in the Cape Hot Way National Park. So that was kind of the chronology. Alongside this, there was work happening from an agreement were happening from the local community, particularly through the Cape Hot Way Ecology Centre and land keepers and the like, in terms of work to restore the habitat in that location, to replant trees and the like. But of course, that's going to be that's a very long term thing. You can't create mature mangums or blue gums or similar overnight in this location. So it is a long term process that we're still working our way through. Something that we did, particularly through 2015 as we went through this process, is we significantly increased the information that we were making available to communities. So what we know is, and for those who are watching, you would have seen it. Quite a lot of media coverage, quite a lot of quite strong views expressed around what we were doing. I'll try to give you a sense of it now, what we were doing. But clearly, there was the risk for people seeing this as just waiting for koalas was high. So we did a lot of work to try and explain what was actually happening. And probably what you can see through that is that people's, as we started to explain what we were doing in more detail, people's views around that shifted. Not everyone, but some. And I think that was important about just trying to be a lot more open and transparent about what we were doing, be clear that it's there, that's why we're doing things, the basis for it, etc. So what are some of the things we learned through that process? Animal welfare, well, firstly, animal welfare was at the centre of this. The reason we were intervening was that animals were there on the staffing. It was underpinned by some expert advice, and that gave us the opportunity to be particularly confident then when we're engaging and telling the story around why we're doing this, is that we're clear that we had a strong basis for why we were doing what we were doing. We were a little proactive in providing information and explaining what we were doing. We'd always been pretty active in that locally with the local stakeholders, the local landholders and the like, but also more broadly. As I mentioned earlier, Kaupo ecologists and some others are continuing to do work around the restoration of habitat in that space, which is really important because what we've done so far is takes off a little bit of pressure from that system, but doesn't fix it in all itself. So we've been very conscious of that. The local landholders are involved in the restoration. Given the nature of the work that's required with koalas, it's not something that local landholders can necessarily do for themselves, so it is something where we've stepped in that way. So that's, and longer term, the question here is about taking pressure off that landscape through translocation and to enable time for the fertility controller to have effect so that population can be managed in a sustainable way. So that was some of the things there. Just briefly, in terms of kangaroo management, so in Victoria, we've got increasing numbers of reports of kangaroos in the landscape and interactions. We see that through the authorities that we issue for people to control kangaroos. So in Victoria, we don't have a commercial harvest of kangaroos. What we have is a process in which we authorise people to control kangaroos in order to mitigate impact on their land or other things. So particularly, most commonly it's agriculture. So that's the process that we have in Victoria. We've seen the numbers of authorities during that time decrease quite substantially. In line with the anecdotal reports we get from the community about general numbers in the landscape. And we also, we're hearing back from the providers, like Wildlife Victoria and the like, about increases in the numbers of call-outs for interactions, accidents, etc. with kangaroos in the period. So that's some of the stuff that we do know at the moment. What our next steps are in relation to that, and some things that are happening at the moment. What we're establishing just at the moment is an advisory group to help us answer some questions around what's the best way to manage kangaroos in Victoria in a longer term, more strategic sense. So we have this process at the moment, for impacts on the cultural landscape. A landholder will come to us, they'll say, hey, they're impacted, we check that. We'll go, okay, you can control a certain number of kangaroos. Is that sort of transactional way of approaching that the best way to do it? Is there a different way we need to look at it? We've got the criteria right, all those kinds of things. Also, what are the best ways for us to try and manage those issues of road safety and community safety kangaroos, and similarly around the period of management. The other thing that I'll just acknowledge is that our government recently announced that there will be an extension to the kangaroo pet food trial. And so, again, the purpose of that trial has been not to authorise any greater control of kangaroos, but simply to say that where kangaroos are controlled and we have dead animals, we have carcasses, to enable those carcasses to be used. So that's the intention of it. It's run for just nearly 2 years now, and it's been extended for a further 2 years, and we're in the process of consulting to determine which additional areas will be used for that. I think I've mentioned realised as I've gone through in terms of where our directions are. We expect there'll be continuing challenges in the interactions between wildlife and community. We do need to think about conservation of common wildlife so it doesn't become threatened. There's questions that we're asking ourselves about what strategic approaches we can use for this rather than just managing them on a case-by-case basis. We know engaging communities in the process is really important. It's fundamentally important as we go through this and we continue to try and break that up and to be more transparent about the way we do this work. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much.